All right, folks, here we go. The moment you've all been waiting for. We're going to use the skills you've picked up in the last three episodes to create a digital version of your geologic map. Things we're going to touch on here are adding a base map, loading your field map and getting that to jive with the base map, drawing your units, making sure you have the proper symbols for the contacts, and of course, adding your data points. Let's get started. First thing I'm going to do is open a new file. Close this file. Centimeters, landscape. I'll title this map. Now, the first thing I'm going to want to do is to add my base map. So we remember how to do this. We click on open. We navigate to where we have such a thing. My base map is here. Yes. Grave point 1 to 100, or 1 to 10,000 scale base map. Open that bad boy up. There we go. Now, I decided to open a separate window, so I'm going to need to select, copy, and paste. Control V, that it looks like everything worked out just right. It fits just perfectly. Now we have our base map added. We can go ahead and close that window. It's not important. The next thing we need is the work that we have done. So you can obtain a scanned image of your field map. I have one of those ready to go. I'm going to open field map without base. Let's see. Okay, here we go. Here's my field map. It looks like selection is weird. I'm actually going to just control A. It will select everything. It looks like the PDF has broken mine into some shapes. Control A, control G, so that it's all the same group. Control copy. Now coming back to my original map document, control V, and well, things are off by 90 degrees, so I'll hold my shift key and rotate 90. Now, this is great, but I can't see my base map. I don't know if I'm off scale or anything like that. So what I'm going to do is select this layer. Turn the opacity way down. Let's turn it down to 35. So now I can see both images at the same time. Control and the plus key is zoom in. So it looks like my orientation symbols here are close. You can see on the bottom of the W there. Got pretty close. I've got some orientation marks down here to the right. This letter R, you can see that it's a little bit off. So maybe I need to shrink it just by a fraction. Looks like these aren't quite perfect on my four-wheel drive here. But they're close enough. This is going to allow us to get going. So at this point, I have my base map and I have my field map added in this wonderful document. So now we're going to do a lot of different things to that. And to keep it safe, we don't want to mess with it. Let's go ahead and just start working on a different layer. So we can lock this layer, this lower layer, and add a second layer. So we'll be working on this red layer, and everything below is going to not be selectable or not be clickable. Okay, let's go ahead and get started. So the first thing that we're going to want to do is to start drawing out our units. And the way that we're going to do that is we're going to draw one large polygon. I'm actually going to draw a rectangle that covers the entire map. And this will be our starting point. So this defaulted, it filled it in. I could make it yellow, it doesn't really matter. we don't want to have it block our view. So again, in this case, we may turn down the opacity pretty far. But you can see everything has a yellow tint because we're looking through that yellow layer. Now, if you remember the Pathfinder command or the divide command from previous, we're going to use the divide command and the pencil tool to draw a line that traces our contact, and then the divide tool will go ahead and chop that out of our rectangle. So just to get started, I'm going to draw the quaternary contact. I'm going to draw this quick so my pencil may not be as accurate. These videos have a 15-minute time limit, so I'm not going to waste too much time being totally precise, as much as you would. But let's get our quaternary unit coming along. And remember that the pencil tool will smooth a little bit when we let go. So now we've got our quaternary. Notice that I drew past the boundaries here. Notice that I actually make sure to go well off of the polygon. There's a very good reason for that. It just makes everything cleaner. So let's make it visible. We'll give it a stroke. And now I want to select. Notice I click to select my large rectangle, my big yellow rectangle, and I'm going to hold the shift key, select my line that I had just drawn. Now both of those are selected. And if you remember, we had used Pathfinder previously. Let's bring that up. And notice I've got the divide option selected. So now I can ungroup because they are always automatically grouped. And now I actually have my quaternary unit that I can have symbolized however I want. I'll actually just keep it a different level of opacity of yellow here. That's great. So we're getting somewhere. The next thing I'm going to do, I'm going to actually trace this contact between, let's say, the contact between the JCC and the JRT. So the orange and the, well, you know what, I'm going to go ahead and do the red one. So we'll draw the lower contact in. Again, to save time, I'm going to approximate because I do have a time limit. So this is my interpretation shown here in dashed lines. Now I'm getting down to my outcrop. And notice this contact dives under the yellow. I'm going to draw it into the yellow a little ways. Let's see, we'll give it a stroke so that we can see it. And now again, I'm going to select the remnants of my rectangle, so not selecting the quaternary unit, and I'll hold control, select this line, divide, ungroup, and now I can actually have my red unit be a red unit. I could put a stroke on it if I needed to. We'll leave the stroke off for right now. Neither of these actually have a stroke that's shown. Okay, one more. We'll do this next green one here. Again, I'm cruising through pretty quickly here. Yours will be different because you've spent the time and you have the time. So do the same thing. I'm going to draw it into the yellow shape a little bit. But when I divide, I'm just going to select the line that I just drew and the remaining polygon. So there, divide, ungroup. And now I have this unit separated out. Let's go ahead and make that thing green. In the sense of going quickly, I'll actually just loop in this andesite over here. And it comes in something like that. Just selecting the remnant, divide, ungroup. Now I've got my blue unit. And so I could actually turn off the visuals of my base map. And you can see I'm starting to get a nice map drawn. It looks like we've got a little bit of a movement issue. This thing moved, left a little gap. You want to try to avoid that if possible. I may have clicked on it and drug it a ways. And I'm just going to go ahead and fill the rest of this orange. Now, we know that was not the case, right? We know there's a little more going on. So I'm going to lock my layer that we had just used, and I'm actually going to turn it off so we can't see what we have drawn. I'm going to go back and select our first layer, and, well, I was going to show you. I'm just deleting that temporarily. I will undo that in a second. If we look, we're getting somewhere, right, with just our base map and our digital color. So I'm going to Control-Z and Control-Z again and get back to where we were. The next thing I want to add is some symbology. So our contacts, I'm going to just look at our upper unit here. Our contacts are going to be different than our fill. And the easiest way I've found to do this is to make a copy of the unit. We had done this in the previous example. Control-C, Control-V, bring the same unit in. One version will have no fill or no stroke, and the other will only have a stroke. So I'm going to go ahead and give it a black stroke. I'm going to turn its opacity back up, but I'm going to give it no fill. So now it's just a black line. And you can see it fits on there nicely. Now I remembered that I could look at my underlying diagram and notice that I, from here on, I have this shown as a dashed line. So if I wanted to make my drawing match that, I would chop it with a pair of scissors, just like so. I'm going to turn that off. And we could select just that portion of the stroke and indicate dashed line like we had done. So now we're really getting somewhere. And I want you to take that this idea, and you should be able to fill out all of the contacts for your units. The one thing to be careful of is to not have two outlines trying to overlap one another. So I used, I could actually chop a large portion here. I'm going to get rid of this portion of our outline. Let's see, make sure I select the right thing here. So I can delete that portion. Either way, there's lots of different ways to do it, but at the end of the day, I want you to have dashed lines where you need to and solid lines where you can. The next thing I want to do is show you how to add data. So I'm going to close my stroke here. I'm going to look at my data points. Now, here I've got a symbol. It's looks like it's striking at 110, dipping at 12 degrees. So what I would do is I would draw, and I would hold the shift key so it draws it at an even 90. You'll see why that's important in a second. I'm also going to put a little dip indicator. I'm going to select both the strike and the dip portion. I'm going to press Control G to make them one, Control C and Control V. Now I have a few more that I've made off to the side, so I'll keep those for later. Now, to make this work, you actually can right-click on that symbol, transform, rotate. And it turns out, as rotated as it is, Adobe Illustrator doesn't quite work in azimuth. But if we have 110, and we know that in this case, 90 is essentially zero, so you either add or subtract 90 from your number. So we'll subtract 90 from this. That means I will have to dial in 20. Or negative 20, excuse me, to go in the right direction. You may need to mess around with this a little bit. So now my strike symbol is located in just the right orientation, so I don't need to label its strike, and I can select the type tool, type a number 12, get it so it's a font size that seems to make sense. and have that stand alone as a digital data point. And now, again, as I start to look at my map, everything's coming together.